Hello everyone, welcome back. In the morning we discussed about gestational trophoblastic diseases today, and now I'm back again to with you to discuss regarding a new topic. So let's crack NEET PG. Let me tell you a little bit about myself. I'm Dr. Deepika Gupta. I did my MBBS and my MD in obstetrics and gynecology from AIIMS New Delhi, and I did my MCH in surgical oncology from Kidwai Cancer Institute, Bangalore. So I've been through the grind of so many medical exams. I have written multiple MCQ examinations myself. So I do understand your problem and the areas that where you need help. And I hope that I can use my personal academic experience to help you out in cracking your next exam. So the first thing that you need to do is you need to download the Unacademy Learning app. You can get it on the Apple Store or on the Google Play Store. And this app will bring to you many, many educators who are like the best in the country, who are doing very well professionally, academically, and who have put in a lot of time and effort so that you might also do this very well in your next exam. So, see where you are in your preparation, whether you are a third year PG, whether you are an intern, whether you are targeting this exam which is coming in April, in the next 2 months. And according to that, you should choose which batch do you want to take, whether you want to take the crash course or you want to take a 2 year batch or 1 year batch and so on. So there are two subscriptions. The first is the plus subscription. Okay, it is a live classroom teaching experience like this, where you can where you have the educators who are giving you discussing a lesson with you. You can clear your doubts there and then. There are also mock tests, there are quizzes, right? Then there is the Iconic subscription. This Iconic subscription has both the Unacademy live classroom experience as well as the Prep Ladder content. So you all know the Prep Ladder content is a lot of lots and lots of pre-recorded videos as well as notes and clinical images available to you with the Prep Ladder subscription. So please use my code Dr. Deepika to get either the Iconic or the Plus subscription. My code will get you a discount of 10%, right? So if you look at it, better to take a longer duration according to your MBBS batch year as well as the exam that you are targeting, right? So please use my code Dr. Deepika. So if you see here, if you take a 12-month subscription, you use my code and you get a 10% discount. You can easily pay this out of your internship stipend money. So now coming to today's topic, that is carcinoma vulva. This is a topic which we don't really read much in detail, but since in the last few years a few questions have been asked, particularly regarding the management, I'll just try to clarify a few points about the management of CA vulva and a little bit about the pre-malignant diseases, right? So again, the outline of the class will be pre-malignant lesions, introduction, epidemiology, risk factors, pathology, workup, staging, management and follow-up. A question has been asked out of each of these things. So we will try to touch upon everything, but not really go into very much detail. So in the pre-malignant lesions, if we see, the most important one is the vulval intraepithelial neoplasia. Okay, sounds familiar. We read about CIN, cervical intraepithelial neoplasia. It is similar. It is the counterpart that occurs in the vulva, right? Then you can have your Bowen's disease or erythroplasia of Currat, which are also HPV related lesions. Then you have your Paget's disease. You can have melanoma in situ. Then you can have lichen sclerosis, which are chronic skin problems, and squamous hyperplasia. So let us look at VIN, vulval intraepithelial neoplasia. So I told you it is similar to CIN. So again, this will also be divided into VIN 1, 2 and 3, right? So again, if dysplasia is in there in the lower third, or it is going up to mid third, or it is going up to the upper third. Same like CIN, right? Then what about their etiology? Again, etiology is of two types for VIN. One is the HPV related, right, which is known as the usual type of VIN. And the other is the one which is seen in patients with lichen sclerosis. So this is your differentiated type of VIN. So easy to write UVIN and DVIN. Fine. Now, this HPV-related VIN will be generally found in younger women. Okay? And all the risk factors that are there, which will potentiate HPV in CIN and CA cervix, are going to act here again in the similar manner, whether it is smoking, whether it is immunosuppression. And the same way as vaccine is preventive against CA cervix and CIN, similarly, vaccine will be preventive against this VIN also. Right? So now let us just read. So VIN is an intraepithelial vulvar abnormality which is limited to the epithelium, excluding the keratinized rear, restricted by the basement membrane. So that is the classical definition of an intraepithelial neoplasia, that it is involving the epithelium and it is restricted by the basement membrane. The incidence of VIN seems to be on a rise. See, why is it seems to be on a rise? Particularly, it is seen that is among the younger women, the HPV-associated VIN seems to be rising, right? Now, since the etiological factor is common between VIN and CIN and CA cervix, you will see that many of these VIN cases have concomitant neoplasia or intraepithelial, other intraepithelial neoplasia of the lower genital tract, which you need to understand. So, let's see. I told you there is a classification for VIN 1, 2, 3. But again, like I told that CIN 1 was demoted. Similarly, VIN 1 has been essentially removed because it is not very easy to differentiate it from normal findings. Then VIN 2, 3 is collectively known as VIN. Okay? So, this was the first classification. You don't need to remember the exact classification. I have just tried to explain you how it has come to be. So, initially there was VIN 1, 2, 3 and then was the differentiated VIN about which I told you. Then again, what did they do? They revised it in 2004 and they gave it as, this is flat condyloma or HPV effect. So, you know a condyloma accumulator which is caused by the HPV, which is essentially benign. Then they gave two types of VIN. One is the usual type, that is the HPV associated, and the other is the differentiated type, which is the lichen sclerosis associated, right? Then came in 2015, again this LCL-HCL classification started. So what did they do? So this VIN 1 group became LCL, the 2 and 3 group or the usual VIN, that is the HPV associated VIN, became HCL. And this last, the differentiated VIN remained the same. So now let me tell you one thing. See, usual VIN, that is the HPV associated, is much more common. This is much more common. Right? Differentiated VIN is lesser in incidence. But the conversion to carcinoma or the progression to carcinoma is much higher in the differentiated VIN. Got it? See, here only 20% will progress and become cancer. But here almost 80% are going to progress into vulval cancer. So that is why you need to know about VIN and you need to treat in time. Okay? So what are the histopathological characteristics? See, there is going to be epithelial thickening. That is, your acanthosis will be there. There is going to be an inflammatory reaction in the dermis. And there is going to be your lot of keratinization and pearl formation at the retipex, right? See, any vulval lesion in a postmenopausal lady, in an elderly lady, you are anyway supposed to do a biopsy to rule out cancer. Even in a presumed genital wart, if you are going to do either an ablation or give medical treatment, you should do a biopsy and rule out invasive cancer. Right? Now, what can be the treatment of VIN? It can be excision, it can be topical, or it can be in the form of imiquimod, that is a immunomodulator. Right? Once you have done this treatment, you will keep the patient under follow-up at 6 months, 12 months, and then annually. You got it? And then I told you, since it is also caused by HPV, the vaccine will be protective against VIN. Now we come to Paget's disease. So I'm sure you have read about this in surgery. Okay. So it can be mammary Paget's, that is associated with the breast, or it can be extra mammary. Mammary Paget's is much more common, around 80%. Extra mammary is less. But in the extramammary Paget's, vulva is the most common site. Now, what happens in a Paget's disease? See, it can be, basically what happens is you will get this kind of a lesion. How will you describe this? This is a very well demarcated erythematous, that is reddish plaque, okay, which is elevated. Now, this can be intraepithelial, that is, it is confined to the epithelium, nothing else is there. Or it may be associated with an underlying cancer. That's why when you see a Paget's disease, you have to be very careful. So in the vulva, it might be associated with adenocarcinoma. Okay. So if it is intraepithelial, you can simply do an excision. However, if there is an underlying carcinoma, you will go ahead for a more radical surgery. But still, the local recurrence rates are higher. Got it? Then we come to lichen sclerosis. Now, what happens in lichen sclerosis? Basically, there will be many bluish white papules that will form, and together then they will all lead to an indurated or fibrosed skin. Essentially, it is a fibrosed skin. It is easy to remember because sclerosis is there in the name, so it is a fibrosed skin, and there is going to be this fibrosis will lead to then introitus narrowing, okay, and this your skin changes will lead to pruritus and discomfort for the patient. This might be seen in the premenarchal girls, or it is commonly seen in the postmenopausal age group. Lichen sclerosis has been seen to be associated with other autoimmune disorders, and on a background of this lichen sclerosis, that is a chronic inflammatory skin disease, you can develop CA vulva. Got it? So this is typically seen in the elderly ladies. Here I told you differentiated VIN will come, and then this will lead to cancer in the elderly or in the postmenopausal age group. Got it? Now, what happens here is that there is thinning of the epithelium. Histopathologically, the epithelium becomes very, very thin, and then fibrosis is happening. Inflammation will be there. It is a chronic inflammatory skin disorder. Now, you know what are retipegs? Retipegs are basically, they are the invaginations of the epithelium into the dermis. So, there is loss of this retipegs in lichen sclerosis. So, this has come as an MCQ before. So, you should know this. Now, we come to our main topic, that is CA vulva. See, these pre-malignant lesions were important to know. Why? Because one is, you should be able to think that yes, there can be a pre-existing condition which can lead to CA vulva. And second is, you should be able to answer some MCQs that come out of it. Right? Now, if we look at CA vulva, see, it is not a very common malignancy, but it is not a very rare cancer also. 4 to 6% of all genital cancers are CA vulva. Now, which age group? Particularly the postmenopausal ladies. 6th and 7th decade. The mean age is said to be 65 years. Okay. Now, I told you that HPV associated VIN is increasing. Similarly, the incidence of lichen sclerosis is also increasing. Both together will lead to increase the incidence of the cancer. This CA vulva is seen more in the developed nations, a little more in the developed nations. Got it? As compared to our countries. Now, the main thing that has to be, you have to be very careful when you have a patient with CA vulva is that she might have other intraepithelial neoplasia or invasive cancer of the lower anogenital tract. Why? Because the etiological agent HPV is there in many of this, and can lead to many cancers. Got it? So, there is a high chance that the patient might be having a second primary at the same time, or the patient may develop a second cancer later on. Got it? Then we go to risk factors. See, in the younger women, what are the risk factors? Your STDs, HPV, and herpes simplex infection. Now, which is the HPV that is responsible? In CA cervix, we read in squamous cell carcinoma, HPV-16, and in adenocarcinoma, HPV-18. Other than that also, we read many HPV types. So now here, in CA vulva, HPV-16, 18, and 33 are commonly implicated, out of which 16 is very, very common. Most common is HPV 16. Got it? Then again, the factors that will cause the persistence of the HPV infection are the risk factors like smoking, alcohol, immunosuppression. In elderly women, you will see that vulvar dystrophy, lichen sclerosis, chronic vulval pruritus, that is all chronic inflammatory dermatosis, skin problems which are causing chronic inflammation. Why is this happening? See, it is said that there is an itch scratch cycle. Itch scratch. Patient will have itching, she will scratch, there is going to be injury to the epithelium, right? This will then start to regenerate, and when it will regenerate, dysplasia will happen. So this is supposed to be the hypothesis behind your chronic inflammatory dermatosis. Got it? Then there are other risk factors. I told you there can be history of CIN, there can be history of squamous cell carcinoma of cervix, and also history of VIN. Right? Then in obese ladies and geographical variations, it is seen more in the European countries. So now we come to pathology. See, one question has been asked from each topic. So we must know this. Now, the most common cancer is squamous cell cancer. Okay, this is 90%. After that is melanoma. They didn't ask you which is the most common cancer. They asked you which is the second most common cancer. So yes, you must remember there is a melanoma also, which is the second most common cancer. Then there are other rarer tumors like adenocarcinoma. I told you Paget's may be associated with adenocarcinoma. There may be a sarcoma. Then you have a basal cell carcinoma. What is this known as? This is the rodent ulcer. Right? So this is locally invasive but does not throw any metastasis. Okay? Or it could be due to metastasis or sometimes lymphomas also. So you need to remember which is the most common cancer, that is the squamous cell carcinoma, and also which is the second most common cancer, that is the melanoma. Now, what are the types of the squamous cell carcinoma? First is your basaloid Warty type, and the second is the keratinizing or differentiated type. See, basaloid Warty is going to be seen associated with HPV. Okay, so everything that is related with HPV will come and fit here. That is, it will be seen in younger women, it is going to be multifocal, it is going to be associated with usual VIN, smoking, alcohol, and immunosuppression will have a role to play. Right, these are 40% of the squamous cell carcinoma. Then keratinizing SCC, they will form a lots and lots of keratin pearls. So this is 60%. This will be seen in elderly women. It will be unifocal lesion, right? It will be associated with lichen sclerosis, squamous hyperplasia, and differentiated VIN. Again, question has been asked from this. You must remember the two squamous cell carcinoma types. Always remember, HPV will always cause non-keratinizing squamous cell carcinoma. It never causes keratinizing squamous cell carcinoma. Got it? So now we come to the pattern of spread. CA vulva, any tumor will have three types of spread. First is your local, second is going to be lymphatic, and third is going to be the hematogenous. Right? So local vulval lesion can spread where all? It can go into the vagina. Okay? It can go into the urethra. It can go into the anus. All these three are basically critical structures, and therefore they have a very important role to play in the staging and the planning of treatment. Okay. Then second is your lymphatic spread. We'll discuss a little more in detail, but what are the basic lymph node groups that are involved? One is your inguinofemoral, and then from there to the pelvic lymph node group. Hematogenous or bloodborne metastasis will go to lung and liver. Fine. Now come, let us just discuss a little bit about the lymphatic spread. What is so significant about the lymphatic spread from CA vulva? See, what happens is in the vulva, drainage is, if let us just discuss the drainage of one side. See, now what will happen? This, all this area is going to go and drain to the superficial inguinal lymph node group. This is your first, okay? From this superficial inguinal lymph node, it will go into the deep inguinal lymph node group. Got it? From this deep inguinal, finally, it is going to go to the external iliac lymph node group. From the external iliac, then it can go further up, right? Now, anterior half of the labia majora will drain to first directly to superficial inguinal only. But posterior half may directly go to deep inguinal lymph nodes. Okay, this may directly also go to deep inguinal lymph nodes. So that's a little cause of worry. See, if we think that and assume that it is a stepwise thing, that first it is going to the superficial inguinal, then it is going to the deep inguinal or the cloquate node, and then from there it is going to the external iliac, right? So this is of each side lymphatic drainage. Now, but still there is a problem. First problem is that your posterior one-third part or posterior part might go directly to the deep nodes. First problem. Second problem is that there is a significant midline crossing of these lymphatics. Now, since there is midline communication, what will happen? A lesion on this side can also throw a metastasis on the other side. So now, what is seen that lesions which are involving your clitoris or the your anterior part of the labia minora or the posterior fauchet. Will typically have bilateral lymphatic drainage, right? So now when they are having bilateral lymphatic drainage and we get such a lesion, we will not treat the lymph node basin on the same side. We will treat the lymph node basin on both the sides. Got it? So midline lesions, that is your clitoris, anterior labia minora, posterior fauchet, will have bilateral lymphatic drainage, which you have to consider in the management. Right? Now, if the ipsilateral node is negative, the risk of contralateral spread is very rare. Very rare. Right? If your inguinal nodes are negative, the risk of pelvic lymph node spread is very rare again. But if your inguinal lymph nodes are positive, then the risk of pelvic lymph node metastasis increases. And as the number of inguinal lymph nodes goes on increasing, like 1 is positive or 3 is positive or 5 are positive, the risk of pelvic lymph node metastasis also goes on increasing. So this is about the lymphatic spread of the drainage of the vulva. Okay. Then we come to history and physical examination. Most common complaint with which the patient will come is a pruritus. So now this has been asked as an MCQ. What is the most common presentation? Pruritus. But okay, let us just imagine a 65-year-old lady has come to the OPD and she says that I am having itching in the perineum and I noticed something, some small growth which is there since last 2 months only. Okay, so it can present in the form of a vulval mass or a lump. It can be an exophytic growth. It can be an ulcerated lesion, right? So, if it is an ulcerated, it may have produced some bleeding, some discharge. So, these are the common presentations. What is the most common site of presentation? Labia majora followed by minora. 60% of all the lesions will occur over here only. After that is your clitoris and perineal area where lesions can happen. Okay. So, if... Now, this was about a typical presentation. Sometimes the lesion may be very advanced or the lesion may be very close to the urethra or to the rectum and the patient will have dysuria or some rectal difficulty in defecation will be there because of the location of the lesion or the advanced stage of the lesion. Sometimes the patient may come with a groin swelling, and if she has completely neglected, there may be an exophytic or erosive tumor in the region of the groin. So when you are examining her, what do you want to see? First, you will do a complete local examination. You want to see the lesion, whether it is a you want to see the size of the lesion, whether it is a single lesion or there are multiple lesions, whether the surrounding skin is normal or it is fibrosed, indurated, patchy, erythematous, what kind of a underlying skin is it, right? So we want to see all those things on local examination. So here, what have I written? Unifocal, multifocal, size of the lesion, right? Now we want to see whether it is a midline lesion or it is a lateral lesion. So what do I mean by a lateral lesion? Any lesion that is more than 2 centimeters from the midline is a lateral lesion. Okay. Anything that is less than 2 centimeters will become a midline lesion. Now, why the concern for midline lesion? Because lymphatics are going to cross. Okay. And you have to address the groin nodes on both the sides. Then you want to know involvement of the critical structures like your urethra, clitoris, vagina, anus. Okay. Then you will do your groin examination and a pelvic examination. So again, I'm telling you, any lesion of the vulva deserves a biopsy. See, just by looking at it, many times you might feel that this is only a wart, but there may be a focus of invasive cancer in it. Or it might be a pigmented lesion and you might think, and on a background of lichen sclerosis, and you might think that this is just an skin disorder, but actually she might be developing a melanoma. So that's why it is very important to take a biopsy and then confirm your diagnosis. So now we come to the investigations. What are the investigations? First, you will again must remember that there is a chance of other intraepithelial neoplasia or cancers. So we need to do a Pap and HPV, and we need to do a complete colposcopy and visualize the vulva, cervix and vagina and rule out a second primary. Got it? So this is very important, first of all. Then we will do a biopsy. Now biopsies can be of many types. See, first is your Keyes punch biopsy. That Keyes punch, I'll show you the instrument. I have put the figure for you. See, this is a cylindrical punch biopsy forceps, and this will go deep up to the dermis. Why do we want to go deep up to the dermis? Because we want to see the depth of stromal invasion. Fine. Then there can be an excisional biopsy. In a very small lesion, you can remove the lesion along with a clear margin. So that will become your excisional biopsy. Fine. You can also do a punch biopsy. If the lesion is very big, you can do an incisional or a wedge biopsy. We generally tend to take a little bit of the normal area as well, so that we will get a clear idea about the stromal invasion, right? So biopsy is very important. So the first thing was your cervical evaluation and colposcopy, and the second thing was biopsy. Now once we have done a biopsy and it has come as a carcinoma, see, if and we have seen that this ideally there should be a comment on the stromal invasion also in the biopsy report. So if the stromal invasion is more than 1 mm, then in that case you will do a imaging, right? So a local imaging can be done, that is MRI. Some books also say PET CT, but MRI, if it depends upon what you're getting in your MCQ options, right? And you can do a chest X-ray. If any abnormality is there, then you can go for a NCCT. Fine. If there are any urinary or rectal symptoms, then you can consider a cystoscopy, proctoscopy. Sometimes you may have a doubt that there is an involvement of the urethra or whether the lesion is going to the upper part of the urethra. So in that case, you can also do an examination under anesthesia so as to correctly identify the stage of the disease. Now we come to FIGO staging. So again, yesterday we tried to learn stage 1 is where the disease is confined to the organ. So same will apply here. Stage 1 is confined to vulva, right? Stage 2 is where it is showing a little local spread, right? Stage 3 will be where there will be loco-regional disease. And 4 will be involvement of adjacent structures or there may be distant metastasis. Right? So, now stage 1 confined to uterus. This is further divided into 1A and 1B. Okay? But how? 1A is less than 2 cm in size, less than equal to 2 cm, and stromal invasion. Stromal invasion has a very important role in CA vulva. Why? I'll tell you. Stromal invasion determines the extent of lymphatic involvement. Okay. Stromal invasion, if the stromal invasion is less than 1 mm, then the chance of involvement of inguinal lymph nodes is very rare, and in that case you don't even need to address the nodes. But if the invasion is more than 1 mm, then the risk of lymphatic involvement goes on increasing with the increase in the stage, right? Now, why are we so concerned about this particular factor? Lymphatic involvement is the single most important prognostic factor in CA vulva. Why? Because if a lady is lymph node negative, her survival can be very high, as good as up to 80%. But if the lymph nodes are positive, then the survival drops to 40 to 50%. So that is why we are so concerned about the lymphatic involvement, and that will be determined by the stromal invasion. So that's why when you are taking a biopsy, you need to take the dermis as well. Only then will you come to know what is the stromal invasion. Then stage 1B is tumor is more than 2 cm or the invasion is more than 1 mm. But still the disease is confined to the vulva, right? Then in stage 2 what happens? There is local spread. Now where will it spread locally? Either it can spread to the vagina or to the urethra or to the anus. So if lower 1/3 is involved, then it is stage 2, okay? Now, similarly, if upper part is involved, then it becomes stage 4A. Upper 2/3 urethra, vagina, anus, or bladder, or rectum involvement starts happening, it becomes a stage 4A. Okay. Now, what is stage 3? Again, the term regional has come here. So, this is definitely lymph node positivity. Now, there are subdivisions for it. We will discuss. But just let us first try to remember the broad outline of the staging. Okay. Now, 4A I told you is that there is upper 2/3 involvement. And 4B will be distant metastasis. Here, I would like to tell you, pelvic lymph nodes is also considered to be 4B disease. Now, this is very important because in all other gynec cancers till now we read, in endometrium as well as in cervix, we saw that pelvic lymph node metastasis was stage 3C2, got it? Whereas in ovary, it is stage 3A, right? But in CA vulva, pelvic lymph node involvement is stage 4B. Whereas inguinal nodes were stage 4 for all those cancers. Here, inguinal lymph nodes are the regional group of lymph nodes. So, we need to remember this. So, now just let us look at the staging a little more in detail. See, I told you stage 1 confined to the vulva, that is local spread only. Stage 1 is confined to the vulva. 1A is lesion is less than 2 cm, stromal invasion less than 1 mm. No nodal mets and all. 1B is lesion is more than 2 cm, stromal invasion more than 1 mm. Okay. Then we come to stage 2. Stage 2 is what? Local spread. So, local spread is where to adjacent perineal structures, which can be lower 1/3 of the urethra, vagina or anus. So, this is stage 2. Then comes stage 3. Now, stage 3 is what? Extension to the basically, stage 3 does is sorry, stage 3 is positive inguinofemoral lymph nodes. Now here there may be involvement or there may not be involvement of the adjacent perineal structures. I told you this. Now there are further subdivisions in this, which is a little difficult to remember. Just let us try to remember it now. See, 3A is further divided into 1 and 2. 1 is if there is one lymph node more than 5 mm. Or if there are one or two lymph nodes which are less than 5 mm. Okay. Then again, 3B also has, here there was one lymph node more than 5 mm. Here there will be two or more lymph nodes more than 5 mm. Or there will be three or more which were less than 5 mm. And stage 3C will be extracapsular spread. Right. Then comes stage 4. Again, I told you other regional structures or distant structures. So 4B is easy, distant metastasis. The differentiating factor is that pelvic lymph nodes are coming in stage 4B. Then comes stage 4A. Stage 4A is what? Again, I told you upper urethra or vagina, bladder, rectum, etc. involvement is 4A. Then 4A also has one more subdivision, fixated or ulcerated inguinofemoral lymph node. Fixated or ulcerated inguinofemoral lymph nodes. Are you guys understanding? Please just write in the chat box if you have any doubts. Then we go to the management options, right? So now again, management for any cancer, three modalities: surgery, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, right? So now let us discuss what all has to be addressed in this and what are the surgeries that are done. So primary surgery one is the surgery for the primary, that is the vulvar lesion, and the second is the lymph nodes that we need to address. So what are the different surgeries that are available for vulva? See, we started from very extensive surgery, right, so that we could give her a cancer free longer lifetime. But what happened was that there was a lot of anatomical distortion in that. So much so that it causes a lot of morbidity to the patient, and the wound breakdown rates were very high because of the extensive surgery. So that was when we used to do a radical vulvectomy with an N-block groin dissection. Let me show you a picture of that. See, like this. You are doing a bilateral groin also, and you are removing the vulval specimen along with it, and this is one continuation specimen. So this is the problem, because here now the closure will come like this, and there will be a lot of tension and there is an increased wound breakdown. Right. So from this surgery, we moved on to radical vulvectomy, but this was done through separate incisions. So in this, what we do? See, here we are addressing the groin through a separate incision, and we are addressing a vulva through a separate incision. Now you might do a complete vulvectomy from this, and you might do a bilateral groin, or you might do a modified vulvectomy. So a modified vulvectomy is what? A modified vulvectomy is where you are removing the lesion with a good margin. So it can be a hemi vulvectomy. If the lesion is located somewhere here, it could be an anterior vulvectomy. If the lesion is located here, it could be a posterior vulvectomy as well. So that is all your modified radical vulvectomy, or also can be called as radical local excision. Now, what is a radical local excision? And I have written one more thing here, wide local excision. So you understood what is radical vulvectomy and N-block groin dissection. We removed the entire thing, both the groin node dissection as well as the vulval specimen together. Right. The second is we did a radical vulvectomy and we did the bilateral groin dissection, but we did it through three incisions. Right. Like this. Then comes your radical local excision. In this, you are removing the lesion. This is a lesion with a 1 centimeter margin all around it. And in the depth, you are going down up to the inferior fascia of the urogenital diaphragm. Okay. So when this is known as your radical local excision, then this is your wide local excision. In wide local excision, we go in up to the dermis. We try to remove the dermis so that we know the extent of stromal invasion. So you can understand this will be done for very superficial lesions. That means it will be done for your stage 1A disease, where the stromal invasion is less than 1 mm. Radical local excision can be done for advanced tumors where there is more stromal invasion. Okay, then is your radical vulvectomy with bilateral groin dissection with separate incisions. This is generally not done anymore. Why? Because there is very high risk of wound breakdown. Then comes your lymph node assessment. How do you address your lymph nodes? You can do a inguinofemoral lymph node dissection. Okay, so unilateral or bilateral. Now this laterality of the lymph node will be decided depending upon the size and location of the lesion. Okay, and upon the nodal status. See, if it is a node positive, then you will not say. Then you can't say about this, I will do unilateral, bilateral. You have to address the node. But if the nodes are negative and the lesion is lateral, that is more than 2 centimeters away from midline, and the lesion is small in size, that it is less than 2 centimeters, then you can just do away with a unilateral lymph node dissection. Okay, but if it is a midline lesion, that is, it is your clitoral lesion, a posterior fauchet lesion, then you need to do a bilateral inguinal lymph node dissection. Okay, then there is also a role for sentinel lymph node dissection. See, the problem with doing an inguinofemoral node dissection is that you are interrupting the lymphatic supply from the lower limb. So, there is a very high risk of chronic lymphedema. So, that will interfere with the quality of life of the patient. So, we can switch over to a sentinel lymph node biopsy in clinically N0 disease. Then, I have written one thing, superficial inguinal lymph node dissection. So, see, we are allowed to do a sentinel, but we are not allowed to do a superficial inguinal. Why are we not allowed to do a superficial inguinal? Because we saw that there are parts of the vulva, that particularly the posterior part of the vulva, that can go and directly drain to the deep inguinal lymph node. So you might do a superficial inguinal lymph node, and then what happens is patient comes back with a recurrence in the deep inguinal nodes. That patient will have a very, very poor prognosis. Right? There is a 100% fatality associated with a nodal recurrence. So that's why we don't do a superficial inguinal lymph node dissection. Whenever we have to address the inguinofemoral group, we will address it thoroughly. Okay, so I showed you these figures, this also. Then comes your chemoradiation and chemotherapy. Chemoradiation or only radiation can be given in the form of either definitive treatment, okay, for diseases which are involving your upper part of the urethra or the anus or vagina, then you can give definitive. Or after surgery, if there are certain high-risk factors, you can give as adjuvant. Chemotherapy is generally given alone only in palliative settings. So now let us discuss the stage-wise management. Stage 1A. Stage 1A was what? Less than 2 cm, stromal invasion less than equal to 1 mm. Okay, if it is a single lesion, you can just do a wide local excision. What do you mean by a wide local excision? Just excise the lesion with the dermis, with negative margins. That much is enough. No need to address the nodes in this. No need for addressing lymph nodes. Then we come to stage 1B. This is more than 2 centimeters or stromal invasion is more than 1 mm. Okay. So now I told you, as soon as the stromal invasion is more than 1 mm, we have to address the nodes. Okay. So how will we address the node and how will we address the primary? For addressing the primary, you can do a radical local excision. What do I mean by radical local excision? I will excise the tumor with a 1 centimeter clear margin. Okay, this 1 centimeter clear margin should be a gross margin and the skin should not be under any tension. When we see histopathologically, then it is said to be an 8 mm clear margin. Okay, or if the lesion is big or it is multifocal, then you might need to do a modified radical vulvectomy, which will depend again on the site of the lesion. It can be anterior, it can be posterior, it can be a hemivulvectomy. Okay, now this I told you is a lateral lesion. It is more than 2 centimeters away from the midline. So in that case, you can do a ipsilateral dissection or a sentinel lymph node biopsy, right? But if it is a midline lesion, then the primary addressing remains the same, but you will do a bilateral inguinofemoral lymph node dissection. Fine. Then we go to stage 2. Now what is stage 2? Stage 2 is where there is involvement of the lower one-third vagina, urethra or anus. Right? So in this case, what will you do? You will do again a radical local excision or a modified radical vulvectomy, and you will address the nodes bilaterally. But if this lesion is very large, or if the involvement of this urethra, vagina, anus is too much and there is a risk of losing sphincter control, then in that case you can also skip surgery first and go to CTRT. You can give the patient CTRT. Okay, again, CT here is cisplatin, sometimes cisplatin plus 5-FU may be used along with radiation, and then after that we can go for a surgery. Right? Then comes stage 3. Stage 3 was what? Lymph node positivity. With a lot of subdivisions, but essentially lymph node positivity. Right? So in that, we will immediately go to definitive CTRT and then we will do a limited surgery. Depending upon how much the response has been, we will decide how much of the vulva to remove and what and how much groin to address. Right? Now comes stage 4A. Stage 4A was where there is involvement of the upper two-thirds of urethra, vagina, bladder. So if you really want to do a surgery in this setting, you will actually end up doing an excentration. But this is a morbid surgery, so we don't want to do that, and we will go to definitive CTRT followed by limited surgery again. Only in stage 4B we will go for palliative chemotherapy. Right? So this is your stage wise management. Now, adjuvant treatment. When will you give a post-surgery radiation or sometimes chemo radiation? When more than 2 or more lymph nodes are positive, there is extracapsular spread or the margins of your excision are positive. So in these cases, you will give a post-surgery radiation. So now, if they ask you a question, a lady has come with a lesion in the right labia majora. It is 1 cm in size and it is more than 2 cm away from the midline. That means what stage disease is it? It is a stage 1A disease, right? So if it is a stage 1A disease, what can we do for that? We can just do a wide local excision. Suppose it was a 3 cm lesion, right? But it was not involving the lower one-third of the vagina, urethra, anus, etc. Then what stage would it be? It would be stage 1B, right? So if it is a stage 1B lesion and it is away from the midline, then in that case you can only address the ipsilateral nodes. And if the ipsilateral node is negative, you can skip the contralateral. Fine. So now again, last is follow up. You will follow her up every 3 months for 2 years, every 6 months for 3 to 5 years, and then annually. Every time you will take a cervical or a vaginal cytology. And if there is any suspicion, then you will go for imaging. So, thank you. I hope you understood. This is a topic which is not to be reading in detail. But since questions have come, let us try to understand the basic management concepts. So, a few things have changed in the management of CA vulva. That is, from extensive surgery for the primary lesion, that is a vulval lesion, we move down. I explained to you how from one single incision we went to 3 incisions, then from 3 incisions we came down to modified radical vulvectomy, radical local excision, and in case of microinvasive cancer, that is stage 1A, we have come down to wide local excision. Right? Then I told you about the lymph nodes. Surgery is used to address the lymph nodes. It's a good modality. If your lesion is small and if it is lateral, you can only do a unilateral lymph node. If the unilateral lymph nodes are negative, you don't need to do a contralateral nodal address. You don't need to address that. But if the patient already has nodes positive, if she's already stage 3 disease, you will go ahead for a chemo radiation, and after that you will go for a limited surgery depending upon the residual disease. Right? So thank you very much. Please use my code Dr. Deepika and subscribe for the plus or the iconic package. If you please like us, subscribe us, follow us on Telegram, YouTube, hit the bell icon. I hope to see you tomorrow for my class of the second part from continuation of the morning lecture, that is gestational trophoblastic neoplasia at 11 a.m. tomorrow. Thank you.